You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Bio 190. Today we have Emily with us, and we are going to be talking about polar seas. But real quick, right before we jump into our live from the aquarium feed and introduce Emily, just a couple reminders. Your field trip paper is due coming up here pretty quick. We also have the first deadline is extra credit, which is this Friday at 11:59 p.m. So if you wanted those 10 extra credit points, please make sure you get that submitted. Don't forget, you have to submit pictures with it as well. Same thing for your field trip paper. You make sure you submit photos of you actually doing your field trip activity to get the full credit. Research proposal is due November 21st, so that's a big project. I would definitely start looking at that now. And for today's reading, we have extra credit, or I'm sorry, not extra credit. We have polar links for you under the assignments tab. So instead of having chapters from our book, actually read the links. Those will give you some information about the Arctic and the Antarctic, or our polar seas. And one last announcement, our midterm is coming up. We are already coming up to our midway point for the semester. That's going to open up October 21st, and you'll have the full week to take that. So it's going to be a, I think it's 35-point question test on all of the classes up to that point. So it's going to be cumulative for the first half of the class. And again, that'll be a week. So that's going to be a busy week. That'll be the same Friday that your field trip paper is due. And then also you'll have your normal weekly discussion board, your normal weekly quiz, and then the midterm on top of that. So start preparing for that now. And with that, we will go ahead and go live from the aquarium. We are going to be at our diving birds exhibit, and we're going to be talking to Julian and Amanda today to learn a little bit more about that exhibit, since it has a lot to do with what we're talking about today. So are we ready to go live?
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you. Hello.
Hello, Kira. So welcome back to the Aquarium of the Pacific. Right now we're standing in front of, or actually I'm sitting in front of our diving bird exhibit. Now this diving bird exhibit is located in our Northern Pacific Gallery. So the water temperature in this gallery in all of these exhibits is going to be really cold, between 50 and 55 degrees. And so these animals that you're going to see behind me here actually live in the Arctic. So not to be confused with penguins, which are found in the South Pole, but in the Arctic, we have animals up here that some of our viewers probably do recognize. Maybe we can zoom in on a couple of them, some of those black and white ones that we see up in the rocks. This exhibit actually has the water here that they can go swimming underneath. They also have the...
I think we lost you, Amanda. I think we lost our visual. Hold on just a second. We might be able to get it back. We'll wait and see. But anyway, Amanda, tell us a little bit about the birds while we're waiting for the visual.
Okay. So anyhow, like I was saying, the exhibit, we have the underwater area. So they're obviously birds that spend a lot of time in the water. We call them diving birds because they are able to dive. They have a little bit denser bones than the typical birds that don't spend as much time underwater. And you'll also notice when we get a visual back on them, when you look at their legs, their legs are actually situated kind of far back on their body, so they look a little bit more awkward than some other birds when they're on land. But also, if you do notice, if we get a chance to see any of the birds that are up on the rocks, you can see they're kind of standing straight up. You can see the color of their legs. There's one that's actually kind of scratching himself right now. You can see some of them showing their wings. Let's see. So we've got, unfortunately, we're kind of looking through the blurry glass, too. So here we have one of our horned puffins, and the reason they're called horned puffins, if you notice right above their eyes, they have this little kind of horn that sticks up. Now, one thing that changes, though, with these birds throughout the year is that different times of the year, their plumage looks different. Their feathers actually change. And so right now, they still kind of have some of their summer plumage, So they have a bright white belly. They have a white face, that horn that kind of sticks up. But then as the summer fades to winter, you know, we're in the fall, we're kind of the in-between stage right now. But as we approach winter, they're going to become much darker. We actually have a couple examples of some birds that are starting to change and not having that bright white coloration in their head. See if we can find any of them for you. Well, there are some of the, oh, there's actually one back there. Now, this one is a different type of puffin. This is called a tufted puffin. And they kind of look in the summertime like they have these big yellow, kind of like eyebrows, big hairy eyebrows right over their eyes. And so those puffins, in the wintertime, they're kind of dark, like you see now. They're mostly dark. You can see a little bit of those feathery sort of eyebrows, which are feathers, of course, not really hairs. But again, in the summertime, they're a bright white face. Those feathers over their eyes are much more pronounced than what we can see now. Now, along with the puffins, we also have our pigeon guillemots, which are pretty easy to spot out now because they're right in front of our window here. They're kind of, they're mostly white with a little bit of the dark markings. But if you were to come back in the summertime when it's full on summer, these birds would be almost all black with just a white patch on their wings. So again, their coloring looks very, very different in the summer versus the winter.
And why is there a different in color, Amanda? Do you know why they would be lighter in winter, darker in summer?
Well, a lot of it has to do with breeding season and, of course, trying to find what makes those other puffins of the opposite sex more attractive to them. So they think that the color has a lot to do with that. But if you think about the environment in the Arctic versus the summer, the summer versus the winter, it is very different, too. So some of those, this winter coloring might help these animals to blend in and camouflage a little bit better than what they need to worry about in the summer months. And honestly, in the summer months, when there is more darker things around them, they're going to blend in a little bit better that way with a darker body. Let's see. Let's see if we can get a view. There we go. Of our crested auklet. So this is another diving bird. He looks different in body shape and structure than the puffins do. He has a much smaller beak, bright orange. He's got that little crest right above his head, which is pretty cute. He flew away. Let's see if we can find another one to show you. But again, you'll notice these birds are actually up on cliffs. Oh, here we can actually see when that is eating, hopefully, or at least poking around for some food in there. They usually get fed small fish, and they can actually hold several fish in their beaks at one time, kind of draped across their beak. It looks like they also have some krill that they're feeding them as well. So these birds will eat different things at different times of year. They'll also, some of these birds will eat plankton, some of the bioluminescent plankton in the winter months, which makes sense because if there's a lot of darkness up there, it's easier to find bioluminescent things than just regular fish swimming around in the ocean. So sometimes they prey on some of the bioluminescent plankton and things.
Awesome. Thank you, Amanda. That was a lot of great information, a good look at all of our diving birds there. So thanks for hanging with us and chatting with us on the phone. And then anything else before we go?
No, I think that's about it. Have a great time.
All right. Thanks, Amanda. Thanks, Julian. We'll see you next week.
All right. Bye.
All right, so it looks like we've got a good look at all the birds there, and those, like were mentioned, are the ones that we find in the Arctic, and we'll be talking a little bit more about animals in the Antarctic as we go through today as well. But before we get started, we'll go ahead and throw it over to Emily so Emily can introduce herself, tell us a little bit about how she got here. Her and I actually started at the aquarium right around the same time. I think you beat me by like 6 weeks, right?
Yep, exactly.
It was kind of funny. I was going to school in Virginia, even though I'm from Southern California. Emily was in Virginia, and we happened to be hired at the Aquarium of the Pacific within weeks of one another, and we both trucked across the United States back to California. So kind of a little funny story. So Emily, tell us about you because you've done some really awesome things.
Sure. Well, hello everybody in Bio190 World. My name is Emily Yam. I'm the Science Interpretation Supervisor at the aquarium. And Kira and I have both been there for about 7 years. That's a long time. I hadn't realized how long it was. So I am an oceanographer by training. So I guess backing up just a little bit, I have a biology degree and a master's degree in teaching, and then I went back to school and got a master's degree in oceanography. And so I I did a lot of work on boats. Part of the reason why I'm really excited to be here today is because I did 3 seasons worth of work in the Antarctic. So I have some polar experience working in krill populations and plankton populations down there. I did a lot of work on ocean-going vessels, and I'm very interested in climate change. So you guys are actually going to see me again later on this semester talking to you about that. So I'm happy to be here. I really love doing this program, and I love getting your questions. You guys always have wonderful questions out there, so anything you want to know, just absolutely send us a message.
And we've already got some coming in, one from Julia. How many different species of diving birds are there in the Arctic? I actually don't know.
You know, I don't know the number, but there's a huge diversity of diving birds. So, for example, in our exhibits at the aquarium, we have 2 species of puffin, we have the pigeon guillemots, and we also have the crested auklets, but there's actually a variety of other diving birds that we just don't show. So, you know, I'm not exactly sure the number,
right.
But there's a fair amount of diversity. There's a number of them. And there's some of them that occur only in the Arctic. There's others that occur in the sort of subarctic, like mm-hmm. colder regions where you would definitely wear a heavy coat, where people would wear a heavy coat. And there's still divers and dabblers that are even temperate. So
right. I mean, we have like the cormorant, for example, mm-hmm. here off of our coast that we see all the time. That's definitely a diving bird. Looks like we have our first phone call today as well. I see a light on there. So we'll go to our phones. Who do we have today? Is it going to be Katie or Dominique first? Dominique. Okay, just checking. It was a good guess. All right, Dominique, what's your question? Hi.
Hi. I would have a question about the aquarium, and I was wondering, like, I didn't hear the name of those birds, and can you tell me the name of the birds?
Sure. Yeah, we had the horned puffin and the tufted puffin.
Yes. That's the name, the horned puffin. And how did they get their name?
They were talking about the horns. Amanda was talking about the horns that you can see, the kind of like the little, it looks like little horns essentially right behind the eye. And we got a little bit of a close up on that. So yeah, if you were to Google an image or a video, you'd be able to see those horns for sure. So, all right. Thanks, Dominique.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, so with that, we will continue on talking about our polar seas today. And Emily, like I said, is someone that will be working with us today, obviously giving us lots of great information since she has been down specifically to Antarctica, which too bad we didn't think to get any photos or anything of you.
I know. Maybe some other time.
Maybe we'll just post them on the Blackboard.
I'm happy to share that.
So. All right, but first we're actually going to start with the Arctic Ocean. And one of the ways I love to start talking about the Arctic is to name the 7 continents. Right?
So, yeah, we can do
Let's
that.
Let's do it. So we have North America, South America, uh-huh. Australia,
yep.
Asia,
yep.
Europe,
uh-huh.
Antarctica,
uh-huh.
and then
Africa.
We didn't mention Arctic in there, which I think brings up a good point. So that's how I always like to start, Arctic Ocean, right?
Yeah, so the Arctic is actually a region. It's not a continent. And if you look at this image that's directly behind me, you actually see this is the Arctic. And the thing about the Arctic is it's not a true continent because it's an ocean and it's surrounded by land.
So this is land,
yep.
land.
And actually you have land from many different continents that touches up onto the Arctic, and the Arctic is just that ocean that's trapped in between all those continents, and it gets frozen. It gets really cold up there, so it's at the top of our planet. We think of North Pole, but it's much more than just the North Pole. It's an entire region characterized by the low latitudes. It's cold, but it's very different than the southern pole.
Which we'll talk about on the second half of the class today. So essentially it's an ocean, but the body of land surrounds it. So you can see like all this is land essentially surrounding the ocean. So that kind of makes it a little bit unique in itself, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, and it's definitely still got characteristics of an ocean. I mean, it's fairly deep. It's thousands of meters deep. So it's pretty deep. It is the smallest of the 5 oceans if you had to draw lines between them. You know, a lot of times we like to think of the ocean as one ocean because they're all very connected. But mm-hmm. if you were to look at just the ecology, for example, of the Arctic, that's a pretty discrete
right.
area. It is the smallest of all the basins. And the interesting thing is it can freeze. because it's really high up there and it's cold.
Right, and we're actually going to talk a little bit about the ice here in just a moment. But one of the things that I always think is kind of awesome is, just to put it in perspective, 1.5 times the size of the United States. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's an average, right? I mean, because it's going to vary a little bit with the ice that we're going to talk about here in a minute. We have a call. We'll go to the call real quick, and then we'll move on to talk about life in the Arctic. So who do we have on with us today? There's Katie. That's always these first two girls every time.
That's great.
So hello, Katie. How are you?
Hi, I'm good. How are you?
Good. All right. What's your question?
I was wondering why the puffins do not need camouflage in the summer versus the winter.
I think that they kind of do, right? She was saying that, which one was it, was she talking about the tufted puffin that was changing colors? I don't know.
Yeah, they actually, just generally speaking, both puffins get sort of darker faces. And they lose that bright, like if you Google a classic image of a puffin, it has like the red, orange, and yellow on its beak. That's mostly for breeding purposes. So that's sort of the trait that stands out for them. And I think it's more for breeding. The brightness is more for breeding than it is for camouflage.
Right. Yeah, no, I agree. All right, Hale has a question. How do polar bears swim and keep warm in the cold water? Hale, hold on to that question. We're going to talk about that on Marine Mammal Day, but that is a good question, so we're going to talk about that. Darren, what animals live near the Arctic, and how deep is the Arctic Ocean? We are going to get to the animal section in just a little bit, but as far as the depth, the average depth we have is 3,658 meters.
It's about, that's like 10,000, 11,000 feet. So that's like almost 2 miles.
Right, deep.
Which is about the average depth of the ocean, actually.
Yeah, average depth.
So that's why I was saying the Arctic is like the other oceans in terms of being deep. It's not just this shallow little bowl. I think a lot of people think that because it's so encompassed, maybe it's not very deep. It's actually just as deep as the rest of the oceans. But what really characterizes the Arctic Ocean is that it's cold. It's cold up there. And so the organisms that live there, life there is just, it exists in a very narrow range of temperatures.
Right. And then speaking of like the different seasons, which I'm going to try and pull this up here in a second too, but we have, this is the area where, depending on the season, we're either going to have total darkness or total light, right? Because we're either...
At either pole, that's true.
So the North Pole in summertime is angled towards the sun, so it never gets a break from the sun. And then...
24 hours of daylight.
24 hours. I could not sleep.
Or close to it. Like, so even if you're in Alaska, so you're not way up on the top, you get a lot of daylight.
Yeah.
It could be like, 18, 20 hours of daylight.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it's really bright up there. But then the opposite happens in the winter. So, of course, the seasons are created by the tilt of the Earth. And so during the winter time, the Arctic is facing kind of away from the sun, and it is dark there. So it could be 24 hours of darkness, or you might have like an 18 to 20-hour day where it's mostly dark, and you might just have kind of like twilight, like sunset, and that might be it.
Yeah,
for the day.
That's as good as it gets.
Yeah, so seasonality there is not just, because we think of seasons, well, here in California, we think of just one season, right? But like, if you think of seasons in the United States, right? Like the fall is when the leaves change and stuff like that. In the Arctic and the Antarctic, at the poles, it's cold all the time.
All the time,
It's less cold maybe, more cold sometimes, but it's light and dark. That's what I think is so interesting. The seasonality is driven by light there.
And then that also brings up the point of having the sea ice, essentially, that changes as well with the season. So because it is frozen ocean, during the winter, there's an average of 5.8 million square miles and approximately 2.7 million square miles at the end of summer, which end of summer we think of as September. That's where there's the least, it's basically the hottest time, so the least amount of ice, as it's been gradually building up to that that summer portion there.
Correct.
And then there's some ice, it doesn't melt, like we don't have a water ocean up there. There's always some ice, right?
There's a little bit of ice, and we'll talk a little bit more about this as we continue our discussion today. I think the main concern, though, is that the ice density isn't what it used to be, and so that is creating challenges for those organisms that are adapted, that they live in a really narrow range. So, but it is very seasonally driven, and I'd love to show them a visualization that you guys can actually see. What does that look like, because you go from a lot of ice in the winter to a little bit of ice in the summer, and over the course of a year, that landscape changes really, really dramatically. So we're gonna see if we can pull up kind of a virtual globe for you to look at, and then you can see what that might be.
Well, we've got the one that's it's every 10 days.
Oh, that's over many years.
Let's see.
Oh, there we go.
September CIS levels. Nope, that's not the one we want either.
We might be able to come back and find it.
Well, yeah, we'll have to come back. Oh, wait, is this it?
No, I think it's CIS animation.
Okay, we'll come back to it. We'll find it. In a moment break. So real quick, we have some questions from Amy. How big is the Arctic in comparison to the seven continents? So all we have basically is the rough estimate compared to the United States, which is the 1.5.
So it's relatively small. I'm trying to think of how it compares to Europe, but I don't actually know how big Europe is
I can see it.
But. Yeah. It's relatively small. Certainly, South America and Africa are much bigger. And actually, Antarctica is two United States.
Right.
So it's a little bit bigger than the Arctic.
Right. Ashley, have there been Arctic explorations where the explorers walk on the frozen ocean, perhaps to explore marine life? A lot of that happens, right?
Yeah. So that's a really great question. Back in the day, we're talking the late 1800s, when polar exploration was sort of coming into, it was sort of popular at the time. A lot of the Arctic explorers would go out onto the frozen ocean and they would sledge. So they would carry all of their gear on these big 6-foot, 7-foot long sleds. I know that we don't sled a whole lot here in Southern California, but if you've ever seen it on TV or ever tried it, they're big and they just put all their gear on it. They put a big strap on themselves and it's like walking or dragging like a big dog behind you, except it can be hundreds of pounds of gear. So walking on the actual ice is common practice. I did it when I was doing research down in the Antarctic as well. You just have to keep testing the thickness of the ice as you go along. Sometimes you have to drill holes into the ice too. So that's really critical. But that's what's really necessary in order to study some of those organisms, especially down in the Southern Hemisphere in the Antarctic. Now in the Arctic in particular, like I said, there's been a lot less ice than there has been. Historically, this past year, we reached the sixth lowest amount of ice that the Arctic has ever seen. And so because of that, you don't have to go on foot anymore. You can go by boat. So it's kind of interesting to think about those changes in the way that we explore and study these areas.
Doria, because the Arctic can get ice in the... Wait, I lost it. Hold on. There we go. Because the Arctic Ocean is so cold, how does the marine life survive in the harsh temperatures? Which we're going to get to that.
We're going to get to that. That's a great question.
Stand by. And then how, Jennifer, approximately how thick can the ice in the Arctic get? Does the thick ice harm some of the marine animals? There are adaptations that animals will have to deal with that sea ice. And then there's animals like whales, for example, that will actually migrate out of the area. And if they were to get caught in that sea ice, they could definitely not make it that year. Mm-hmm. So
the average thickness of the Arctic is 6 to 12, 15 feet thick, thereabouts. Historically speaking, I don't know what the actual average thickness was this past year.
Right.
Like I said, it's because we're seeing different changes in the ice. In the Antarctic, it's really different. We'll talk about that a little bit later, but mm-hmm. There's a lot more ice there.
Right. And Darren, why is the Arctic always cold?
It's because it's low latitude. So if you think about the way that the sun heats the planet, like the sun really gives us all of our energy. The highest and lowest latitudes receive a lot of sunlight, but they're the least direct because they're at the top and the bottom. And so it just gets cold there. And the Antarctic gets even colder than the Arctic, and that's because it has an ocean surrounding it. So it doesn't interact with anything.
Real quick, Emily, is this the one that we wanted?
Yes.
Okay, we got a visual for you. Let me back it up. Oops. All right, so if we can go to the computer really quick. This is, I brought this up a few times. This is our Science on the Sphere website that NOAA has that I utilize quite a bit. So this is a data set, and this is essentially showing the sea ice throughout a season. I think I've got it slow enough.
Maybe I should speed it. It's pretty slow.
Maybe I should speed it up a little. Are we going?
Oh, it doesn't look.
It's going. It's just slow.
Okay. Maybe speed it up even more.
Yeah.
So as you guys look, you can see. Ooh, There are sort of different subtle changes in the colors there. Some of it's very white, some of it's like bluish white. And that's because they're trying to show you the difference between really dense ice and not as dense ice. And you can see over the course of 1 year, you can see a lot of white growing there. Right?
So this is essentially winter time right
now,
right?
Yeah, so we can tell that it's winter because the whole ocean is frozen over. That's the hole in the donut, right? But then, of course, we also have lots of snow and ice pack on the actual land there. So places like Greenland and Iceland and northern Canada and Siberia, those places are going to have snow on the ground there. So that's why the Arctic seems to really grow.
And you can see real quick too, you can see that this is the ocean. These are the waterways here, right?
So the grayish part there, it's really subtle. If you guys look really closely or look at this on your own, you'll see that the sea ice is pretty solid there. But as we move towards summer, you can see it to start to recede away there. And so this is a pretty dramatic change in this ecosystem. And this happens all the time, because during the winter it's big and during the summer it's small. But now what we're noticing is that if we look at all the smallest seasons, if you were to compare all the smallest year to year, the smaller is getting smaller and smaller.
Right, absolutely.
If that makes sense.
Okay, so kind of a cool animation there. We can put that link up for you as well. All right, we have a couple questions. Hale, is it harder to explore the colder waters of polar seas than to explore warmer waters?
Well, I think they have they both have their challenges,
right.
I would say.
Adriana, can you die living in the Arctic?
Yes,
it's freezing up there. It is super cold if you're not properly prepared. There's limited food resources, and we're actually going to hit on that with some of the challenges that the animals have. Katie, what is the temperature variation in summer versus the winter in the Arctic?
When we talk about air temperature, I think it can be, in the summertime, it can be 40 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
Too bad. It's not bad, but in the wintertime, it can be well below zero.
Right.
So you have a huge range.
Variation, huge range there. All right, let's go to the phone. We have someone calling in. Who do we have with us today? Hello, Paris. I should have known you would have been calling. What's your question?
I wanted to know if there are people that live there that practice ice fishing.
Yeah, no, there's nobody that lives in the Arctic, right? I mean, it's...
There's like, indigenous, sort of...
On sea ice?
Oh, not on sea ice, though.
Not on sea ice, right? So it would be, any of the land that's surrounding, but the actual sea ice portion, nobody lives on
Lives on the sea ice.
Right.
That's correct.
Yeah. All right. So we're going to move on and talk about some animals in the Arctic. Real quick, we already talked on the perennial ice, yes, and the seasonal ice. Okay. So let's talk about animals in the Arctic. And this has a really awesome food web that starts pretty low, but we have these things called, or the solution called brine. And the brine happens essentially from the crystallization of the ice, right?
Yeah. So as the ice crystallizes, it actually makes, it almost looks like chimneys, like you guys can see in this picture behind me. And that's actually a really important feature of the sea ice there. And it makes these little channels, basically. Like I think of them as chimneys, right? But what happens is these tubes are actually really productive areas. And you get flow coming through there that bacteria can grow there. And actually detritus and dead plankton and algae and things can accumulate there. So it becomes a really important food source for things that would otherwise have no food coming from above because it's frozen
on
the top.
And the algae, right? Like the algae that grows can be like meters long, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like it can't be like super long.
Yes,
it grows off that brine.
It depends on the different types of algae, but they're basically, there's a lot of different varieties of this under ice algae that just thrive in these types of environments. So they can be sort of chain forming. Some of them are clumpy. Some of them are like immediately attached to the scrub. So there's all these different types that live under the sea ice.
And we have a really cool little visual. If we can show that visual of the food web real quick, that would be a good time. And it just goes to show how it all really starts. Hopefully we can, dealing with the plants and algae here. On the bottom. So there's the ice algae. We've got the phytoplankton. Then we've got like some of the zooplankton. We've got the plant eaters here. typically microscopic, and then it really starts the food web. This is the reason we bring this up is it's a little bit different, where the main driver of the food web in Antarctica is krill, where here it really starts with those brine channels that gets everything kind of going, and we'll talk about how the krill are those that keystone species when we get down to talking about Antarctica. But you can see it's a pretty complex food web here.
Yeah, that's why I actually like this diagram. It's in a place where there aren't a ton of options, they make up for what they can do. So a lot of things eat a lot of other things up there. And so I think that's a really, great way to look at that system, is that it's a harsh place to live. And so you just have to make do.
And then when those when the algae dies, the algae feeds tons at the ice, rather. Mm-hmm. But then when it dies, it also feeds a whole group of animals at the bottom too, right?
Right. So there's an entire ecosystem that's based off both of the life and the death of plant-like material. Mm-hmm. So when we look at algae, it can be either ice algae or even the phytoplankton that lives there is seasonal as well.
Yeah, and that the benthic, right? So that dead algae that falls to the bottom literally drives this whole kind of unique food web in itself. Mm-hmm. That's on the bottom there. All right, let's talk about some of the fish in the Arctic. There's about 240 species, roughly. Most are benthic, though, right? They're going to be feeding on the bottom.
Yeah, it's very productive. It's a lot harder for them to go hunting in the water column when it's, like we said, it's a really harsh environment where they know that they can go down to the bottom, just like you were talking about, and find good food there. And so we have a bunch of different varieties of fish there. Some that I think are really, if you guys look up pictures about them, they're pretty cool looking. There's one called an eel pout, which is common up there. There's another one called a snail fish.
We have pictures of those too that we can show.
Yeah, so those are great fish. Just two examples of fish that live in these really extreme habitats.
Let's show the picture of the eel. Oh, there it is. The eel pout's right behind us. They're kind of interesting. They have a cartilaginous lower jaw. And they do a lot of feeding on the bottom. So they just open their mouth and kind of scoop up all the food in the bottom, right?
Right, yeah. So they have to go sifting through the mud and stuff like that. So they have to have that jaw that's able to scoop everything up. And that's just so that they can get to where the worms and invertebrates are living.
The cartilaginous jaw, does that just make it more flexible, I guess, right? Versus bone?
Especially if you're going through what I call a substrate, right? But like mud. Mud is thick. Mud is hard to scoop through. And so having a little bit more flexibility in that jaw really helps them get those benthic or bottom-living invertebrates.
And then the snailfish, they're a close relative to the lumpsuckers, and so they have like a disc that allows them to like grab onto things, right?
Yeah, they have these really modified little fins, and it's kind of like a suction cup almost,
right?
Except that it literally is made of their fins there.
So just kind of interesting, to think about the cartilaginous jaw, going back to the eel pout, I think is a perfect example of adaptations that these animals will have when, most of the food's going to be at the bottom, that they have to figure out. Obviously, they're not thinking about it and figuring out. They're evolving over many millions of years, but to adapt to those kind of environments, which, as you mentioned earlier, I think perfect, super harsh.
Mm-hmm.
All right, mammals of the Arctic. There are roughly 12 species of marine mammals that regularly inhabit the Arctic. That includes some whales, polar bears, walruses, and seals and sea lions, which we're going to be talking about them on Mammal Day, so we're not going to talk too much about them now. But I did bring up migration, and one of the most famous migrations that come out of the Arctic is the gray whale migration. We have a cool map to show that migration. We're actually going to be getting into gray whale season here pretty quick if you like to go whale watching. So this is the submarine grounds of the gray whale. They're up here feeding. There's lots of things that they love to munch on, especially out of the mud and the substrate, which going back to just kind of that thriving substrate. Once the sea ice starts to freeze and expand, they're then going to leave the Arctic, and they follow the coastline all the way down to Baja. There's a set of lagoons down there, San Ignacio, and they go hang out down there in the Some are in the wintertime, and they'll have babies, they'll mate. We see them right here, so we are essentially right here in Southern California, so we see them going south and going north, and we see lots of calves when they're heading back up north, because that's what they've been doing, is giving birth in that warm water where the baby's nice and protected, helping that baby gain lots of weight by feeding him milk, and then they'll head back up to the Arctic, feed and try and blubber up again for the following year and do it all over. So we're going to be coming into that probably in November, December. We'll start to see some of our first southbound gray whales. Abby, what's the most common type of algae found on the brine?
I actually don't know the answer to that. I did not study those actual algae. I studied phytoplankton, so I don't know. We'll see if we can find that out for you, though.
Yeah, for sure. All right, as far as conservation, like you have been mentioning a lot about global climate change, and you'll be back on global climate change to talk about this, but we've been seeing a big decrease in sea ice and that the temperatures have significantly increased up there, right?
Yeah, so there's some evidence that shows that the rate of the temperature increase is actually fairly fast there. And so I want to make it clear, though, that it's a rate issue. So we're not looking at actual... it's cold there, right? It's cold there no matter what. So, but the thing is, when you look at the rate of change, it's like, how fast is that changing? That's what's really alarming. And so over the past few decades, the warming in the Arctic is dramatic and much faster than I think anybody had really thought it would be.
Yeah. What is it that they say that the Arctic has raised almost twice the rate as the rest of the world in just a few decades. So
yeah. Once again, that's just looking at the rate. So that's right. Not the absolute temperatures, but for one place that lives in a really narrow band, that's a significant
jump there. Absolutely. We have a data set, again, from the Science on the Sphere website that will show from 1987 through 2013 every 10 days. So we're going to see the fluctuations of winter and summer. This isn't the September to September, I don't think, mm-hmm. right? No. Mm-hmm. So we'll take a look at this one, and then we have another one. Maybe we can find that when we're on break next. But this will just show you, I think, overall, from 1987 to 2013, how different it is.
Yeah. As Kira mentioned, you will see seasonal changes. You'll also see annual changes, so what it looks like from year to year. So
we can go to the screen. Can we go to the, there we go.
So it almost looks like it's pulsing. So that's the seasonality that you are seeing. And it's sped up really, really fast. So we're looking at these little changes over 10 days, documented for decades. But if you look at the pulsing and look at the small section, that's what scientists are very interested in studying more about, because the small is smaller.
We can slow it down, too.
Every year.
Oops, that was brightness, wrong one. So they're essentially studying...
I mean, they're studying the whole system, right. but when you look at it, you know, when it looks like it's pulsing, and when it's at the small point,
like right
if
there.
You think about comparing, that's probably September or so. If you think about comparing September from one year to September from the next year to the next year to the next year, that's when you can really see patterns. And of course, climate occurs over many years, so they have to look at it over many, many years. And so, for example, when I said that the Arctic is the sixth smallest ice that they've recorded in a recorded history, so in satellite history, they're looking at the entire record and stacking them up.
Let's see if we can find that one real quick. We're just going to look so you can look with us on the website here. We were trying to find, should we put in sea ice again and see what comes up? So we want the...
It's September sea ice.
Surface temperature, shipping.
There we go.
This one here. Mm-hmm. This is the one we wanted. Okay. So just to, like Emily said, just to remind you what we're looking at, this is going to be comparing September to September to September to September, starting in 1987 and going to 2013. So we're 1987 right now in September, so this is expected to be the least amount of ice for the year because it's the end of summer, and we'll take a look.
And so they keep looking at all the Septembers through all this time. 2012 was actually the smallest recorded Arctic, whereas 2014 is the sixth smallest. And you can even see at some points the entire, that passage above North America is completely free of ice. So I think a really, really interesting way of looking at it.
I don't know if it's when it starts over versus when it's like.
Yeah, it's a little too hard. It's hard to see the ticker on this one, on this particular
screen. Yeah, I think it keeps restarting because I've seen some of the same ones, like those super low ones. Those are going to be the 2012, like 2012 and 2013. But what a big difference, I mean, just from that, when we first started that to what we were just looking at. I mean, pretty significant difference there.
Right, and there's also things that impact the rest of what's happening, like these feedbacks, right? So if you think about like ice, like how much white there is on the planet, ice is highly reflective, and so that can change like climate. That can actually change what's happening over the course of, of time. And when there's less white, there's less reflective, that changes the whole dynamic. There's less ice than there was. There's less stuff reflecting off of our planet.
It's like if you're going to wear white, if on a hot day, right, do you wear a white t-shirt or do you wear a black t-shirt? You wear a white t-shirt because it reflects,
gets rid of the,
it reflects everything off. That's essentially what the ice does. It reflects the heat off. But as the ice melts and you're starting to see more of those darker colors, open ocean versus frozen white, just like a black t-shirt absorbs the heat, so does the land and so does the water, kind of pushing that to heat even more. Yep. It's called a positive feedback loop. So it just keeps it going. There's nothing that's going to stop that loop.
Yeah.
The less ice makes it warm, or you know, less reflection, so it gets warmer. More warming causes more melting.
Right.
More melting causes more warming. So it just keeps going in this vicious cycle.
Yeah, so it's called a positive feedback loop, not because it's a positive thing, but because it keeps going and going
One pushes the other, that pushes the other,
yeah,
that pushes
the other. Yeah, it's like dominoes are positive, positive feedback.
All right, with that, we are at a good time to take a break. When we come back, we will start looking into Antarctic and the Southern Ocean. So Antarctica is a continent, and we'll be discussing that. Oh, we need just a minute, so we'll just keep on talking. So real quick, while we're waiting to go to break, why don't you, Emily, tell us about the expeditions that you did down there a little bit?
Sure. So I went to the Antarctic a while ago, actually, and I did two seasons on an icebreaker, and so the boat was reinforced in the hull, the front of it, so it could actually break through ice, and then that's when we actually studied krill populations, which we'll talk about. We won't talk about my specific work, but we'll talk about how important krill are in the Antarctic, so that was really cool. And then I did one season where we studied phytoplankton, and I ran a whole bunch of experiments on land, but we had to go collect our samples out on the ice. So we actually grabbed all of our gear, like I was saying, like with the big sled behind me, and I would like run across the ice, and we would have somebody in front of me making sure that the ice wasn't too thin so I wouldn't fall through to the ocean. Very exciting.
Sounds awesome. All right, so our break is ready. So again, about 5 minutes, grab a drink, grab a snack, whatever you got to do, and then we will start with Antarctic ice, or Antarctica and the Southern Ocean when we get back.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You ought to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. To want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 to change the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
well. Go Toros.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live, interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back from break. So we are going to dive right into the Antarctic and Southern Ocean. And Southern Ocean is kind of new, right? Like that's essentially a new ocean.
Yeah, it's relatively new, I guess, in terms of what we're calling things. I think when I was growing up, we didn't call it that. Back when I was growing up,
yeah.
We didn't call it that. So the Southern Ocean is anything that's actually below 60 south latitude. It's the ring that surrounds the Antarctic continent. So that's on the bottom of the planet in the southern hemisphere. And basically, as soon as you hit under 60 south latitude, you are in basically Antarctic waters, even though you may not be touching the sea ice or you may not be touching the continent either.
Can we bring up the image? We have the Antarctic ocean image I want to bring up real quick. So there we go, that's what I'm looking for.
Yep, so if we were to take a globe and look at just the bottom there, you can see the Antarctic continent there, and then the Southern Ocean is the ring around it. So it's sort of like, I think of it as the opposite of the Arctic, right? When we were talking about the Arctic, we were talking about a whole bunch of land that surrounds an ocean, and here we actually do have land in the middle, but it's surrounded by ocean, and because it's so isolated by the Southern Ocean, the Antarctic has a really, really different environment. It's actually much harsher and colder.
Right. And you know what? I totally forgot, Emily. How could you let me forget this? We forgot to do mystery item, which is
right here. That's right. Let's back up for one second.
I just wanted to talk about Antarctica so much. Forgot to do the mystery item.
Me too. But I want to show you guys the mystery item.
I know you were excited about this one. So we have our mystery item right here on the desk that I think we're going to try and get a visual on from our above camera here. So again, this gives you an opportunity to get a participation point.
Here's some scale too. Here's my hand.
Perfect. So you can type or call in. Here's another opportunity for participation points. And you have to guess what that is. Looks like a mummy.
It does.
But it's not.
It's not. It's a good one.
All right. So, can't wait to see what you come up with for this one. And ready, set, go. Okay. So, moving back. So, we'll come back to Antarctica. You said it is extremely harsh, right? So, would you say harsher than an Arctic environment?
Yeah. It's definitely colder down there. So, because, as I mentioned, because it's surrounded by ocean, there's not a lot of interference by land. Land is quite warm. So because of that, it's very, very cold down there. The coldest recorded temperatures on Earth were recorded in the Antarctic. And it's a big place, too, as I mentioned before when we were trying to compare it. The Antarctic continent itself is about 2 times the size of the United States, but it also grows, of course, just like the Arctic does. When the Arctic gets more frozen in the winter, the Antarctic also gets more frozen in its winter. And so it sort of almost doubles in size just because the ocean around the continent, that comma-shaped continent that you saw, the ocean around it freezes. So that's what's so spectacular
about it. So
it
makes it look like the continent is bigger, but it's just the sea ice has grown around the continent and it's the same?
Yeah, like, and it's oftentimes stuck to parts of the continent just for the season. And
so like in the wintertime, you could be like 1 foot on land and 1 foot on ocean, so you're on ocean, and then you're on land, and then you're on ocean, and it would kind of be the same thing. So, all right, we have our first guest, Elizabeth. Is it some kind of bone?
That's a really good guess.
It kind of looks like that. I could totally see that. It is not a type of bone. If we need to give you hints, we will, but not a bone. So we're going to keep seeing if anyone else guesses, but thank you for being the first one to try it out. All right, so back to Antarctica. So the ice is up to 4 kilometers thick in some places.
Yeah, that's like 2 miles.
That's insane.
Yeah, so there's land covered with ice, and then it's so cold with that land covered with ice that the ocean around it also gets frozen.
That blows my mind. I don't understand. it says the average elevation, 7,546 feet. The highest ice cap, 13,451 feet. And Mount Vinson, is that right?
Yes.
16,066 feet.
So, yeah, the thing that's interesting about Antarctica is people don't think about it. Out of sight, out of mind. It is the highest, driest desert on the planet. It receives actually very little precipitation. And so the ice that's been piled up on top of the continent, that 2 miles of ice, has been there a very long time. And so it's just really interesting to think about it. It's that extreme. It receives very little precipitation, super dry. It's actually very windy in some parts of it. And it gets really cold, as I mentioned. So the record cold temperature for it, for a long time, actually was recorded in 1983, the first record that we sort of have track of, and that's because it was at a Russian station called Vostok. That was minus 128.56, so 128.5 below Fahrenheit, below zero. That was at Vostok. They actually have since found a colder place, the East Antarctic. That was actually measured by satellite, so it wasn't like somebody was there with the thermometer, but they measured it by satellite, and it was minus 135.8 degrees Fahrenheit, which is minus 93.2 degrees Celsius.
That's freezing.
Yeah.
What was the temperature like when you were there?
So I worked there two winters. The coldest that I had experienced was minus 60 degrees Celsius, and that's wind chill. So it was a little bit warmer than that air temperature. Wind chill, that's minus 60 degrees Celsius, which is minus 76 degrees Fahrenheit. We only worked outside for a few minutes, and then we went inside.
Oh my gosh!
it's really cool because like your eyes are watery, and my eyelashes would freeze. So anytime I went outside, you would get like these little ice crystals around your eyes.
Who wants to go to Antarctica?
It was amazing, though. I totally recommend it.
There are opportunities, right?
Like there's always opportunities to do research there. So there's very little tourism that actually happens on the continent proper. But if you're really interested in oceanography or science or even physics, astronomy, almost all the sciences have some presence in the Antarctic. The wonderful thing about the Antarctic is it's basically a continent that's twice the size of the United States that's devoted to science.
And nobody owns it.
Nobody owns it. It's actually sort of run by international treaties. So there's many different research stations. So for example, the United States has three research stations in the Antarctic, but we don't have like a claim.
Right.
There's sort of like some informal claims. It looks like they cut it up with a pizza. That's not actually really observed it's not observed in a strict sense. It's not like you have to get a passport to go from the Danish version to the United States or whatever. Like it's not really like that. It's really, everybody there is really collegial. So they like to work together. They collaborate together because it's a whole continent that's devoted to science.
All right, let's go back up. We had some guesses real quick on the screen. We'll see. There we go. Ashley, some type of worm.
Not a worm.
Good guess. JC, is it a white sea anemone?
No.
Not a white
sea. I can see why you might say that, but it's not.
Jennifer, is it krill? Not krill. Hail, have any of you been to Antarctic and Southern Ocean? Yes, we've been talking about that with Emily.
Obviously,
yes, it's very cold. And is the item on the table a type of shell like to a lobster tail?
Oh, you're getting closer.
You're getting closer. So yes, it is not a tail, but it's like the exoskeleton of a lobster. We'll leave it at that, but yes, it is not a skeleton of a lobster.
And just to add on to Hale's question, there are people that spend their time in the Antarctic. About 10% of the population there at any given time are scientists, and the rest are support staff. And for example, at McMurdo Station, one of the American bases, there's in the summertime about 1,000 people that live there. So some 100, 150 that are actually scientists, and the rest are technicians and support staff. But there are some bases like Palmer Station, which is another Antarctic research station operated by the United States. It's like 30 people, so.
Not a ton of people there. do any other oceans get cold enough to create sea ice?
That's a great question, Abby. It is just the Arctic and the Antarctic are cold enough to get sea ice, and it's just that the sea ice is changing the way that it looks, but those are the only two places that get sea ice.
Right. I mean, you might be thinking of like lakes that freeze over, right? But those are different conditions. One being because that's fresh water, it freezes easier than salt water does, which makes the conditions for sea ice having to be much colder, which is why you might see, you know, our ocean doesn't freeze, but the lake does. So.
Right. And oceans freeze below freezing.
Yes, it has to be below freezing.
It's actually, so when we think about it, in Fahrenheit, we think, 32 degrees Fahrenheit or 0 degrees Celsius, that's when things freeze. In seawater, it's actually minus 1.8, I think.
Mm-hmm. So it's got to be a little bit cooler. So let's talk about the water a little bit. We've talked about the currents before on Oceanography Day and kind of started understanding currents a little bit better. We talked about density, that kind of thing. There's this essentially great ocean conveyor that works around the Southern Ocean, right? Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
So there's there's actually a big circulation pattern. Like you can think of it as like a river in the ocean, and the way it moves is by temperature and by salinity. And because the Antarctic is so cold, there a lot of the movement of this circulation is based on what we call Antarctic bottom water, and that's because cold water is denser. And so when you think about the whole circulation moving around the entire planet, part of what keeps it driving is this cold source that's in the Antarctic. So you have Antarctic bottom water that spills down into sort of this big movement of ocean, and it's driving a lot of that circulation just because there's differences, as I mentioned, in temperature and salinity.
We watched a really cool Bill Nye the Science Guy video on that, actually. Ours was salinity currents more so when we were talking about the mixture of how it sinks and things like that, but still the same idea with things that are more dense, you know, cold water more dense than warm. So this conveyor belt flows around the bottom of the Atlantic, Pacific, and Indian Oceans, and then lots of water mixing as it goes. So we have a couple of videos that I want to show you. They don't take too long. One's like, I don't know, 30 seconds. The other one's a little bit over that. So let's go ahead. Well, actually, hold on while we're getting the videos propped up. JC, is it a nudibranch? Not a nudibranch. Ashley, it is a whalebone or a scale worm.
Both really good guesses, but not quite.
Julia, is it a bivalvia or a bivalve? Not a bivalve. JC, real quick question. If the cold water of the Antarctic was to interact with the warm water of the Pacific, would it create any type of reaction or pressure difference?
So the cold water of the Antarctic actually does interact with water from other oceans, but it's not so extreme because this water actually takes a long time to move from one place to the other. So it's not just like putting hot water next to cold water. It gradually is cooling as it moves towards all the way down there. So so it does actually create movement though. So that's actually why we have this thermohaline circulation. That's actually what it's called.
Right.
And so you're on the, that's sort of right, JC. It creates a reaction, but that reaction actually takes a really long time. If you were to actually mark like a little molecule of water and follow it for its entire journey all around the planet on this thermohaline circulation, it would take about 1,000 years.
That's insane.
Yeah, because water doesn't move very, very far.
Right.
But it's slowly moving in ways that we don't, we can actually observe scientifically, but you may not just like go out there and watch it. Like it takes too long to do that. But it's actually moving throughout the entire planet. And that's how heat is distributed. That's one way that heat is distributed throughout our planet.
And we'll take a look. So it looks like we've got that first video ready. So let's go to this one first. So this is the ocean conveyor belt. So it'll zoom in here in just a moment. We're going to kind of get a look at all the currents around the world, the water movement, and we'll get down to... right now we're up at the Arctic, but we'll get down to the Antarctic in a few moments and you'll get to see how all this water kind of comes together. So it almost shows that water that's warmer coming up, cooling off, sinking because it's cooling down, it's colder, it's more dense.
So a lot of times when we learn about thermohaline circulation, so thermo meaning temperature and haline meaning salinity, we start in the North Atlantic, and so you can see water from the Arctic flowing down through the middle of the Atlantic. It's wrapping around, and you can see it actually joins up with that Antarctic bottom water. Can you guys see how there's like a ring around Antarctica? Sort of, it's a little bit harder to see it, but it joins up down there, and based on the temperature and salinity of these water masses, they actually move in this conveyor belt around the planet. And as I mentioned, that is actually how temperature is distributed. That's how water molecules move in the ocean. But as I mentioned, it's a very slow circulation.
Kind of cool. All right, we have a second video. And once we get done with the second video, we have a bunch of guesses that came in. So we'll get to those guesses. If we can show the second ocean conveyor video. This one's not as cool because it doesn't have the pretty earth behind it. But here's that ring you were talking about.
Yeah, so you guys can see the Antarctic, that's the gray comma looking, I mean, it looks like a circle with like a little tail attached to it. That's the Antarctic continent proper. There's a lot of little, circular motions that are around it, but you can see by and large, there's a big donut around it, a big circle. That's the Antarctic circumpolar current. Circum meaning around and polar meaning pole. Right? So the Antarctic circumpolar current moves around and around and around, but actually the other currents from the other basins sort of touch at different points. And that's a part of what drives that circulation pattern.
Awesome. Okay, let's go. We have some guesses here. So Ashley, let's go to Ashley's guess first. There we go. Is it a white Antarctic lobster tail or hand? It is. Okay, so you got the exoskeleton part. That's right, but not lobster. Let's go to Paris. Is it an amphipod? Closer than we've been
amphipods
so far.
Amphipods are squished this way. They're squished this way.
And then we're going to skip that. Let's go to Julia's real quick. Pretty sure it isn't, but looks very much like a white dried sea cucumber shovel-nosed lobster. Yeah, no, you're both picking up on good visuals there. And the winner for today, Jennifer.
Jennifer, yes, Jennifer guessed.
So she says, is the mystery item an isopod shell or exoskeleton? And...
correct.
Yes, it is.
So this is the shell of a deep sea isopod, also called Bathynomus. There are some that are much bigger than this. This happens to be a Japanese variety, still quite large. If anybody has ever seen a pill bug or roly-poly, like in your garden or at the park, this is sort of like the distant ocean cousin of it. Some Bathynomus can get to be about this big or like the size of... kind of like of a big sub sandwich, if you think about it that way. This guy is, of course, a little less than the size of my hand. You can see all these great segments on the side here. Each segment has a little pair of legs with it. And then this is its head, and it has little mouth parts that are like little antenna that sort of like rub together. And it has this big flat tail in the very back and all these little legs. So these are, this is a deep sea species, and... we have them on exhibit at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
Super cool.
And so this is a molt too.
I feel like we might have seen one on Deep Sea Day when we were in Wonders.
Oh, in the gallery.
Oh, you know what? We were going to look at them, but we didn't go live last week. Never mind. We were supposed to show you those last week, but we didn't because we didn't go live.
There's some that are bigger, too. It's pretty neat.
Yeah, yeah. All right, with that, we'll bring up our question of the day for the folks that either still need another participation point or if you are not watching live, this will give you an opportunity for a participation point. And then also you'll want to write in a question. So the question of the day, how many penguins can a polar bear eat in 1 hour?
It's a good question.
It's a good one. I think they can figure it out.
I hope so.
I think it'll be a good one. So don't forget under the participation tab, make sure you put it under there, no emails. I know some of you have emailed me because there were issues with Blackboard. That's totally fine. Also, just to let everybody know, starting this week, if you answer any of the questions or submit questions for participation points in the comment section, you won't get credit. It needs to be in the assignment tab under participation. So when you click on participation, click on today, don't write anything in the comment section. There's an actual box that's like the submission for the assignment. So that's where you want to type that in. If you have any questions, let me know. All right. So... question of the day again, don't forget, how many penguins can a polar bear eat in an hour? All right, don't write in because we're not answering it here. It's something for online. Okay, animals of the Southern Ocean and Antarctica. So let's jump in and talk about some of the animals because these guys have got some crazy adaptations.
Yeah,
right?
It's an amazing place because it's very, very extreme. The food web is a little bit simpler than what you have in the Arctic just because there's fewer options. So while we have sort of the same tiers, right, like there's producers and there's consumers, we have phytoplankton there. The keystone species here is krill. When I say keystone species, I mean its importance is much more than their numbers would suggest. And there's actually a lot of krill that are down there. But it's the main thing in the food web. It's actually what, if you look at the arrows, a lot of the arrows go back, if you were traced backwards, hit the krill. And that's because they're so important.
Let's pull that full screen again, and we'll kind of show that again.
Yeah.
So you were saying, so we have krill here, right? We've got birds that could feed on krill.
Yep.
There are seals that'll feed on krill. And then we have fish that feed on krill. The penguins feed on krill, but the penguins also
eat the krill.
Feed on krill too.
Yep, and then there's the squid, there's other invertebrates that eat them. There's a lot of different animals that make use of the krill. And I would also mention that the other seals that it says, don't discount that. The seal biomass that's down there, crab eater seals alone, it's like tens of thousands of them.
So there's a lot.
A lot. mm-hmm. like to rival the biomass of like whales.
Yeah.
And they're much smaller. So cool. There's a lot of crab eater seals.
Yeah, quite a bit. And we'll talk about the crab eater seal and what makes them special here in just a moment. So let's talk about the sea ice and how that kind of goes back to the krill, because we can pretty much say that every animal either eats krill or relies on animals that eat krill.
That's correct.
Essentially in Antarctica. But yeah. with the krill, they feed, especially the juvenile krill, mm-hmm. feed on algae under the sea ice, right?
Yeah, so they have to make a living somehow during this really tough time. I mean, it's dark half the year, light half the year. It's really, really cold. They eat, especially the juveniles, as you mentioned, eat the under ice sea algae. You can even see this krill right here has that sort of brownish green gut. That's because its gut is full right there. So you can see it's been using its teeny little mouth parts, which are kind of like antenna, to scrape away at that under ice krill, under ice algae, sorry. And just as a point of reference, it's really hard to tell how big the krill is here. They are anywhere from about 2 inches long to like three and a half inches long. I sort of think of them as like the length of my pointer finger.
Right.
So they can be very, very large.
Yeah.
The krill that live here in California don't get nearly that big.
Right. We've actually been seeing a ton of krill off the coast right now, too. Mm-hmm. But yeah, much, much smaller. I would agree with that. So this is one of the most abundant multi-celled animals, and it's thought to be one of the largest aggregations of marine life on the planet.
Yeah, and they live in swarms, what's really fantastic. So you may not see them swarming right in this image right here with the krill under ice, but if you were to be on a research vessel with me, for example, you could like look over the side in the open gaps between the ice and you can see swarms. It looks like this pink cloud mm-hmm. underneath the surface of the ocean. We actually get swarms of krill here that are the Pacific krill, the little ones, but the Antarctic krill really swarm. And it can be a swarm that's like a mile long.
That's huge.
It's huge. I mean, like some of them are
huge. Imagine what's that going to feed too. I mean, that's going to feed so much. And mm-hmm. again, that's why, you know, base of the food chain there. And surprisingly, they can live 5 to 7 years.
Yeah, they're a pretty long-lived animal. They are just really hardy, and so they know how to survive. They reproduce in large numbers, so they have all the adaptations they need in to survive that really harsh environment.
We have a really cool video that shows the krill feeding on that algae and then also these swarms of krill. So if we can bring that video up, I think this will really kind of bring home what we're talking about in terms of how they eat and then the swarms as well.
And this shows you a nice image of what it would feel like if you guys were diving underneath the sea ice there. You can see a little krill right there. And it's feeding, so you can see its little legs moving really fast.
They have big eyes, too.
They do. Some of them have much bigger eyes than others, depending on the species there. So these are all euphausids, so this is the big krill, but they also have a handful of other species that exist in the Antarctic as well. But they do have really big eyes. And you can see the little green gut right there. Their gut is like directly behind their eyes. So for those of you that can see that, that's where their stomachs are. And that's how they move. So they have those little swimmerettes, those little swimming legs that they flap back and forth. Otherwise, they're not very huge swimmers, because they're planktonic. They mostly go with the flow. So really beautiful footage, I think. High definition footage of them eating under the sea ice.
We're gonna see some swarms here in a second. I know because I watched the video earlier and I was like, oh yeah, that's awesome. That's so many.
Here they are. Look at that. You can see all their little guts. That's the dark part, the guts and eyes.
And so that's what you were talking about.
These giant swarms can be a mile long.
Are these the krill? Yeah, those are the actual krill right there too, right?
Mm-hmm. Looks like it to me.
I mean, that's intense.
Yep, and you can imagine, like, this is why there are whales down there. This is why there are tons and tons of those crab eater seals that I mentioned, and lots of penguins and things like that. They all rely on this really abundant and important food source.
So let's talk about some of the other animals that live there that either directly rely on the krill or indirectly rely on the krill. We'll start with the Antarctic cod. And this is kind of a cool fish. They have special blood, essentially, right?
Yeah, somebody had asked earlier how these fish can survive. So for example, this particular fish, it's not a true cod. It's just its name is Antarctic cod. And they have antifreeze in their blood. So it's just special chemicals. It's not the same kind of stuff that you would put like in a car if you lived in the Midwest. But it works the same way. So it keeps their blood from freezing in these sub-zero temperatures. And the same thing happens actually with ice fish as well.
Right, I was going to say, what kind of other fish have that? I don't know if I know of any that.
Yeah, the ice fish, which is, I think we have another picture of the mackerel ice fish.
Right, the mackerel ice fish, right. Yeah, we'll get to them in just a second here.
Yeah, it's similar, but their blood's interesting. It's clear.
Uh-huh.
So it's
I didn't know that.
It's different.
Did you, by chance, see any of these fish when you were down there? Like, what kind of fish did you see?
We didn't see a ton of big fish like this. This is a slightly bigger fish. And that's just because we were towing plankton nets. And so plankton nets generate a lot of pressure that can only pull in little guys. And so, for example, we would tow through like a cloud of them or a swarm of them if we could. And Ashley just asked, how many krill are in one swarm? It can be millions. The exact number, it would depend on the size of the swarm, but it can be millions.
Is there like a number that they would consider, like anything over 5,000 is considered a swarm, or does swarm mean just they're clustered together?
I think they just look for a physical sign, like a cluster of them.
Got it.
So there's no threshold.
Speaking of the mackerel ice fish, so they get their name from the pale white color, and then you said that they lack red blood cells, so that means that they have that.
Yeah, and they also have that long, pointy snout-looking thing. Some of them have almost translucent-looking skin, not this particular one, but if you guys were to Google an image of them, they're pretty crazy-looking. We would every once in a while see some of these, and they're actually not very big either. Mm-hmm. Most of them aren't very big. Because it's a tough place to live, and so there's not as much food as you would think, and so things stay small.
Now it says that they transport oxygen within their blood using plasma instead of red blood cells, right? So that's why there would be the lack of red in their blood. And then they're eaten by seals, and they're commercially harvested. I'm not much of a fish eater, but...
I don't actually know what people use them for, because I don't think that there's much meat on them.
That's what I was going to ask. That's kind of what I was leading to, is I wonder what kind of...
Yeah, I'm not so sure, actually.
I don't know. We have the Patagonian toothfish, and they're commercially fished extensively, right?
Yeah, so much so that they're endangered, basically. Mm. I don't know the exact IUCN status, but I would guess that it's if it's not threatened, it's definitely endangered. This is a fish that I know it looks kind of creepy right here, but you guys have probably seen it on a menu.
I wanted to look it up, too, because...
Yeah, the Patagonian toothfish is also sometimes called Chilean sea bass. And so it's one of those things that for a long time people were really into them, right? Like people thought they were really tasty and all this stuff. So there was a lot of fishing that happened of the Chilean sea bass or the Patagonian toothfish. But they are, they're sort of overfished now. And so they think that fishery is not sustainable.
Right. If we can go to the computer, I have a picture of, I think, a live one. Well, not alive anymore, but gives you an idea of what that gnarly mouth looks like.
Yeah, they call it a toothfish for a reason. Look at all those teeth right there. So that's the Chilean sea bass or Patagonia toothfish.
So crazy looking. All right, now let's talk about that crab eater seal. Kind of an interesting name since it... doesn't really eat crabs?
Yeah, it's interesting. I think in the early days of Antarctic exploration, they would find these. And, back in those days, it was like you caught something for a scientific specimen and you'd dissect it and things like that. And so they would, open up the bellies of these guys and find all this pink stuff inside. Mm-hmm. And they're like, oh, it must be crab. And it turns out it's actually krill, but they named them crab eater seals because they thought that's what they were eating. And so crab eater seals, which we used to call crabbies when we were working, are fairly big seal. And there's a lot of them down there. There's tens of thousands of them, millions of them probably.
Actually, yeah, it says estimated population of 15 million.
Yeah, I mean, they live in these giant, giant groups too. So like there's lots of them down there. They eat krill.
That's, yeah, we have a picture of the jaw here too, or the skull, in a minute, but just some kind of interesting facts about the number. So it's second only to humans in the numbers of animals, and they're the most abundant species in the Southern Ocean.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I guess if you have tons of krill to eat, right, it might make sense there. So let's take a look at their jaw. They have a really interesting set of teeth, if we can go full screen on this.
So really beautiful. Look at those teeth. Look at the shape of the teeth. I always like to say, like, that you can always tell what something eats from its teeth, right? Your teeth say a lot about what you eat. And so they have those teeth that perfectly mesh together, all those little jagged serrations. Excellent for grabbing krill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and their main predators are leopard seals, which leopard seals have got kind of this crazy reputation.
Yeah, they're even bigger than crab eater seals. I think they look like Tyrannosaurus Rex. If you could like sort of encapsulate a Tyrannosaurus Rex, that's what I think they look like. I mean, that head is really, really long. Think about the size of like a small horse, right? Like, it's like a foot long head. It's a really, really big head, lots and lots of teeth. It's a huge animal. I mean, I think they're second only to like elephant seals in terms of their size. So they're huge. And they're excellent predators. I mean, the leopard seals eat crab eater seals. They eat penguins. They're incredible hunters, incredible. And I've even seen like a YouTube clip of a National Geographic photographer, I think, that had his camera out, and a leopard seal came and like bit at the camera.
Oh, yeah.
It was absolutely incredible footage. And so this is one of the top predators down in the Southern Ocean. The only thing that eats this animal is the orca.
Mm-hmm.
So something with the next bigger sized mouth.
Right, absolutely. They travel the greatest distances of all Antarctic seals as well, although I'm not totally sure. Do you know what kind of traveling they would do? I don't know offhand.
I don't know what their migration patterns are.
Yeah, they move quite a bit. And then, you know, when you see other seals, a lot of times you'll see like rookeries or that kind of thing, and we'll see a bunch together, but they kind of hang out a little bit more by themselves.
Yeah, it's unusual. They're much more solitary. We would see them kind of lying off in the distance, and they're huge. I mean, they can be like 11 feet long. Oh my gosh. So they're huge. You can definitely see them, especially if it's ice, giant thing, ice. And so we would see them out there and just be on high alert kind of because you don't want to interact with an animal that's that big.
No,
we didn't want to
be vicious.
Yeah, we didn't want to be anywhere near them. So, so we stayed away, but we could always see them.
Yeah, they're popping up out of the ocean or out of the ice like that. Ice. Yeah. There it is now. All right. So speaking of penguins, since they like to eat penguins, let's talk about some penguins. Now I know that a lot of people think like, oh, penguins, they must live in the snow, in the ice, that kind of thing. But it turns out that that's not the case. There's a lot of penguins that don't live in Antarctica and don't rely on ice for surviving, right?
That's true. Most of the penguins that are out there are actually temperate. So there's 17 species of penguin, and only two of them live on the Antarctic proper. And then there's a handful, maybe three or four of them, that live in the Southern Ocean or maybe in Patagonia, but not on the Antarctic continent proper. And so it's actually fairly limited, even though we have this image in our head of like ice and snow and penguins.
I feel like we get a lot of questions, like, because we have penguins at the aquarium, which we'll see. I think we're going to go live. We're going to try and go live on penguin or on bird day. We'll go to the penguins. But I feel like people always go, oh, aren't they too hot? Or like, how come there's no ice or anything like that? But they don't need it. They're not normally in those environments.
Yeah, they like I said, a lot of them live in rather temperate environments, kind of like here, except maybe not as dry, of course.
Yeah.
They live in areas where there's cool water sometimes and plenty of food.
Right. I was looking at the thing here. So we have four that are considered Antarctic, the Emperor, Adelie, Chinstrap, and Gentoo.
Yeah.
And the Emperor and the Adelie are the only ones that live there like pretty much all the time.
Right.
And then there's the sub-Antarctic, like you said, King, Royal, Rockhopper, and Macaroni.
Mm-hmm.
I love that one.
Yeah. I mean, I saw, while I was down there, we saw Emperors, Adelies, Chinstraps, which we called Chinnies. We saw Gentoos. So we saw the main ones, but the majority of what we saw were actually Adelie penguins.
Yeah, little guys. We had a couple questions here. Let's go back up and answer those real quick. So from Amy, would the Antarctic cod be able to survive if it didn't have the antifreeze in its blood? Probably not. That's what allows it to survive and for its blood to not freeze is that it does have that chemical mixture that prevents it from freezing. And we have AV, just a quick question about the krill. Do they lay eggs and why are there millions of them?
They do lay eggs, but they are brooders. So just like a lot of other crustaceans, because it is a type of crustacean, think about like a shrimp. They're not really shrimp, but they're sort of cousins of shrimp. They do have eggs. They just make a lot of eggs, and so it's a really productive area. And actually, the babies, we caught a lot of babies while we were down there. The babies are about the length of your fingernail, your thumbnail, about 1 centimeter across, and they're called Priscilla as babies, and then when they grow up, they become juveniles and then adults. So, that's sort of the reproductive strategy that you see in animals where there's lots of them. They make lots and lots of eggs. Some of them are brooders, some of them are spawners, depending on the type of animal, but you'll see them put a lot of effort mm-hmm. into making thousands and thousands yeah. of eggs, whereas mammals will pop out one or two or, you know, like six eggs tops, like, or like eight, right? Like dogs and cats have litters that are not 10,000.
A lot of care into it.
Yeah, and then they put a lot of care into it. Whereas a krill or something that would make thousands or hundreds of thousands of eggs, there's rather minimal parental care involved with that.
So speaking of eggs, let's jump down and talk about emperor penguins, which is the largest penguin species.
They're huge.
They're, about 100, wait, what?
They're like 4 feet tall.
Yeah, I was going to say, wow. Anyway, they're the only penguins that breed during the Antarctic winter. Mm-hmm. And these are the ones I think that everyone's really familiar with
yep.
that do the egg passing from the feet. So they don't have a nest. They just carry the egg on their feet. They pass it off from mom to dad to try and keep it warm.
Mm-hmm.
And the males will incubate while females return to sea for about 65 days until the eggs hatch. And then the males will fast for that entire time.
Yep. It's a lot of work.
Yeah. Real quick, because we're really short on time, we have a video that shows emperor penguins that do a little wave, and this shows how they're going to stay warm in these really crazy temperatures. So if we can bring up that video real quick, and then we'll wrap up with conservation of Antarctica and kind of the challenges that's going on down there, and that's going to wrap up our class. So let's go to the video real quick.
Temperature is as cold as minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit. It helps if there's a warm body nearby. Emperor penguins in the Antarctic are known to huddle together for warmth. But what we didn't realize was that they were creating a wave when new penguins joined the huddle. And that wave helped move the huddle en masse. Physicist Daniel Zitterbart from the University of Erlangen-Nuremberg in Germany recorded high-resolution time-lapse images of the huddle near the Neumayer Antarctic Research Station. They were then speeded up to see what was happening. As penguins move in, generally from the rear, penguins in the huddle make small steps in a formation to help the tightly formed mass remain intact. Zitterbart and his colleagues point out that it is crucial that the huddle is continually reorganized to give each penguin a chance to spend sufficient time inside the huddle compared to time on the periphery. The wave is created by the small steps, estimated at just 2 to 4 inches. The researchers suggest those steps serve 3 purposes. First, to keep the pack as dense as possible. Second, it leads to forward motion of the entire huddle. And thirdly, over time, leads to its reorganization. Separate, smaller huddles can also merge into larger clusters. The emperor penguins in these videos are all male.
All right, there we go. So that gives you an idea of how they really huddle and kind of do this little wave. So we got just about a minute left. Real quick, Emily, wrap up for us in about 15 seconds. What are some of the issues going on with Antarctica and the warming temperatures?
So with climate change, there's actually a significant retreat or melting of the ice shelves, especially on the West Antarctic Peninsula. So if you remember thinking about Antarctica like a big comma, that little tail right there has actually had significant loss of sea ice because it gets warm there, and it's sort of a regional effect that we see there. there. And the thing that's important about that area is that there's a lot of krill that lives there. There's a lot of penguin rookeries that happen sort of like on the inside right here. So there's a lot of systems that are dependent on even just that little portion of the Antarctic that's heating up. In fact, that little comma is heating up way faster than the body of the comma.
All right. So we'll talk about that more on Global Climate Change Day. So that wraps us up for this week. So thanks for joining us. Great participation today. Don't forget to work on your discussion board, participation points, and your quiz. Midterm's coming up, and our extra credit is due on Friday. So if you're going to do that, make sure you get it in, and we will see you next week.
Bye.